Please be seated now. Our service is about to begin. Good morning. Welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Congregation of the South Jersey Shore, a welcoming and inclusive faith community. We kindly ask that you turn off your cell phones. Our service is open to all, visitors, friends, and members. Whether you are single, partnered, or a family of any type, we welcome you. Whether you are here in the sanctuary with us, watching live online or on demand, may our time together be one of learning and celebration. My name is Colette Johnson, and I am your worship associate this morning. I am a member of this congregation and currently serve on the Faith Action Board of Trustees. Our worship service today is led by Katy, Sastre. Katy is the executive director of First Friends of New Jersey and New York, an organization dedicated to upholding the inherent dignity and humanity of immigrants who are impacted by the immigration enforcement system, particularly those who are held in immigration detention. Prior to joining the staff, she was on the First Friends board and co-chair of the advocacy committee. In addition to her work with First Friends, she is also on the steering committee of the Latino Action Network. Katy has over a decade of experience working in nonprofits, specifically in the service of immigrants, refugees, and asylum seekers. She has worked at the New Jersey Alliance for Immigration Justice, Immigrant Justice, the Northern Manhattan Coalition for Immigrant Rights, the International Rescue Committee, and the International Center for Transitional Justice. Katy is a graduate of Cornell University with a BA in Sociology and Government and SOAS, University of London, Masters of Gender Studies. Video of today's service will be available on our YouTube channel later today. There are a few announcements for this week. After the service today, members should stay for the annual meeting. We have to elect new members of the congregational committees, and we will vote on the proposed changes to Article 2 by the UUA. Join us next Sunday for our own Teresa McReynolds. While the spring equinox begins this journey and represents new beginnings, the summer solstice represents the next step of this divine rhythm. Always occurring at the start of the Cancer sun season, and the summer solstice reminds us to turn inward and find the nourishment needed to grow and evolve. For us to grow, we must accept even the passing of the sun. Welcome to worship.
Sorry about that.
Your troubles make you cry. Don't waste a moment wondering why. When everything goes wrong, you have to go on, do it or die. Do it or die. Your bad breaks go getting you. had enough, you still gotta try. Do it no matter what the people say. It don't matter, it don't matter at all. They don't know you at all. Die before you let them stand in your way. Don't you know that you should know? That life is a gamble all along. Winners or losers, you keep rolling on. So go on and roll the dice. You only live twice. Do it or die. You've got nothing to lose. Go on. Roll the dice. You only live twice. Do it or die. Welcome
into this place of healing. Welcome into this place of challenge and growth. Welcome into this place of imperfection and aspiration. Here you are whole. Here you are holy. Here you are wholly loved. Our chalice lighter today is Geraldine McCluskey. Please join me in reading the chalice lighting words in your order of service. A child journeys far from home, fearful and brave, in need of safe harbor. Let us welcome this child into our home with warmth, nourishment, and love. Would we not want the same for our own child, lost and alone in a strange land? Please rise now in body or spirit and sing our gathering hymn, number 188, Come, Come, Whoever You Are. Is provided in the foyer in which you are invited to write whatever joys and sorrows you have as you enter. I will now read what you have shared. From Karen York, send love and positive vibes to Colby, who is having some health challenges. We love you, Colby. Thanks to Paul and Helen for a lovely evening of wine, food. And I think it's the wonderful company. Paul and Karen A. Sorry, guys. Also, from Rick and I, we had an amazing time last night. Thank you, Paul and Helen. Let us share a quiet time together to reflect upon our week. During the musical interlude, you may come forward and place a pebble in the water to acknowledge a personal joy or sorrow. In just a moment. Sorry, little technical issue. So sorry, I was just enjoying the music. Let us be in the spirit of prayer. Blessed and holy creation, universe of wonder, mystery beyond definition, we share today our joys and sorrows, listening deeply to the things that cause us to weep or worry, and lifting our hearts as one at those things we would celebrate together. Our hearts are touched by this shared ritual, and we are connected. We hold in our hearts this morning the poor people of Gaza, the innocent people that are just being slaughtered. And we pray for the people of the world who just want to do something about it but can't. We pray for those who are apart from us, whether by distance, time, or conflict unresolved. We pray for those who thirst, whether for water, dignity, or justice. We pray for those who are in danger and who yearn for safety. We pray for our small, blue, fragile planet. Amen.
David, there's still a high feedback going on. I would just bring the overall volume down. I think it's the monitor over here, the choir's monitor. They're very, very naughty today. Yep. See?
It's muted.
It's muted.
Yeah.
Maybe is it my microphone? Do you want to turn off my monitor? Maybe it's that.
Okay.
No, I'm still hearing it.
We don't hear
anything. All the dogs in the neighborhood are freaking out right now. I'm just telling you right now. The dogs and the chick singer. Yeah.
No,
it's still there.
It.
Do you hear it?
Mm. Well, now it's done. Right? There it is again.
Everyone with good hearing, I apologize. Everyone that doesn't hear it, good for you, because it sounds like it's a very high frequency, yeah. Mm-hmm. But we're going to sing through it, so there's that. I invite my choir to come on up here and sing with us.
Do or die.
We're going to breathe in, and we're going to breathe out, and we're going to do it all over again.
Take up an offering during our service. It's good to remind ourselves from time to time that the offering is symbolic as well as practical. We know that it's through pledges that we build our budget and fund our yearly programs and ministries of worship and religious education, pay our staff and professional religious leaders, and finance the comfort and beauty of our building. Today, we will also be taking a second collection for the Eastern Service Workers Association. Please be generous to them for the good work they do. If this is your first time visiting us today, please feel free to let the basket pass, as your presence is gift enough. For those who are participating online, please visit uucsjs.org and click on the yellow donate button for ways to donate. The morning offering will now be given and received in the spirit of grateful fellowship. Ushers will come around again to collect for the Eastern Service Workers Association.
Supposed to stand on the platform or not, but
yeah, because they want to see you.
Okay. We'll do that. Good morning. Thank you all for having me here. I really appreciate Deb inviting me and all of you listening to me speak. As Colette mentioned, I'm Katy Sastre. I work for First Friends of New Jersey and New York. And this is us during some of our recent activities, doing some advocacy work. First Friends has been around since 1997. The organization was started by a group of volunteers at that time who were interested in visiting detained individuals at the Elizabeth Detention Center. It's currently the last immigration detention center that is still in New Jersey. So at that time, there was some... Oh, I'm pointing at the screen, just like you said I was going to. I'm so sorry. So at that time, some volunteers got together. They got some initial funding from some religious organizations, including the Methodist Church out of Newark, and they started this program. Over the years, this has been quite expanded to come to include other kinds of programs, which I'll walk you through in a little bit. The visitation program eventually expanded to other immigration detention centers. We used to have, and I'll explain a little bit more about this, we used to have three county detention centers, all in Northeast New Jersey, and those were public immigration detention contracts. Those three have since closed because of some developments in the state, which we'll walk through. But we were supporting folks for a long time in those three county detention centers, and then programs were expanded to include a pen pal program, commissary support. It's like your canteen account, I guess. So it's how you get food, hygiene supplies like soap and shampoo, It's how you buy stamps and paper and pens and stationery supplies so you can write to your family or your lawyer. So we do provide funding for folks' commissary, bond funding, legal referrals, and other kinds of support for folks who have been in detention. And I'll point it that way. Yeah, that feedback is still there.
I'm trying to get rid of it, sorry.
Thanks. So it's really important, I think, to situate us in the context of like what really is immigration detention. A lot of people have heard about it in the news, but they're not entirely sure what it means, how you end up there, and really how that impacts people's lives. I won't be able to run through the entire impact that immigration detention has on an individual, but I do think that there's some important things to know when we're discussing immigration detention. So it is civil detention, meaning you're not being held for a criminal charge. However, people are held in prison-like conditions. In fact, most people, 90% of people, are held in detention centers that are run by private prison companies. They're run no differently in many ways than a prison. But because it's a civil detention, you do not have the right to legal representation. And there's no sentence per se, it's indeterminate length. We know people who have been detained for 2, 3, 4 weeks, and we know somebody who we just, a volunteer just met her outside of the Elizabeth Detention Center last Friday. She had been detained for over 5 years. She was a victim of abuse, has a disability. I mean, there's just you don't know when you get detained how long you're gonna be in there. And that's part of the like mental abuse that people really live under. So IGSAs and private contracts. These are how most immigration detention centers function. An IGSA is an intergovernmental service agreement. So that is between the federal government and a state or county, some kind of local or state government. So that's what the Hudson County, the Essex County, and the Bergen County immigration detention centers were. They were intergovernmental service agreements. You also have private contracts. The Elizabeth Detention Center is run by CoreCivic, which is the largest private prison company in the world. Over 90% of people who are held in immigration detention as of last summer, this data, you know, is as accurate as of last year, are held in centers run by private prison companies. Currently, there are 37,360 people detained across the U.S. There are many, many, many more on alternatives to detention programs, which, despite their name, they're ankle shackles, they're wrist watches, they are other forms of surveillance, and really other forms of really essentially detaining people outside of a detention center. You've got curfews on some of these programs, and the federal government continues to expand the programs and the ways in which they can monitor people, even when they're not detained. So who ends up in detention? Because that's the number one question I get. People want to know, well, you know, somebody must have ended up there for a reason. They must have done something. There are a couple of ways that you can end up in detention. If you present yourself at a port of entry, so the vast majority of that 36,000 number, you will be detained usually for a period of time. This includes the Mexican border, which is the one that we think of most as our port of entry, but this includes like flying into JFK. You know, we have a board member who was previously detained at the EDC, the Elizabeth Detention Center. Please stop me if I use acronyms and you're like, what is that? His brothers were killed in Sierra Leone. He fled Sierra Leone, presented himself at the airport, and then he was detained at the Elizabeth Detention Center for 4 months while his immigration case was decided. So often people are just held while their immigration cases are making their way through. Another reason that people end up in detention is because they may be subject to something called mandatory detention. This is something that we work on a lot because a lot of the folks that we support, unfortunately, this is just something that happens to them. If you've had some kind of interaction with law enforcement, maybe you've been convicted of certain kinds of crimes, you may be subject to mandatory detention. One of our other board members went to prison for 18 years and then was detained for 4.5, despite having completed his full sentence. In that time, his permanent residency was also revoked. So I think, you know, when we talk about the 1996 laws, people talk about the 1996 laws in the context of immigration a lot. We're not going to get into the full range of what that means, but in 1996, President Clinton, so this is a bipartisan problem, passed two laws. One of them was the Anti-Terrorism and Effective Death Penalty Act, super dramatic, and the Illegal Immigration Reform and Immigrant Responsibility Act. They essentially expanded the grounds for which someone could be detained or deported, and that included permanent residences, right? So it just, it took the list of convictions that somebody could have and expanded the list of convictions or crimes or felonies that you could have been charged with that allow you to then have your permanent residency revoked and or be detained and deported. And so combined, these two laws basically led to the deportation and separation of hundreds of thousands of families in that past, what is it, almost, you know, 28 years. And because of the realities of the U.S., you know, and our racist criminal legal system, the majority of the people who end up detained and deported are Black immigrants and or other immigrants of color. When you walk into an immigration detention center, it largely looks like men of color. And that's because of the way we've set up our systems. So that's why I mentioned the 1996 laws. Then when we look regionally at what has happened in New Jersey, a lot has happened over the last 3 years and a lot continues to happen. So 3 years ago, we helped push through a law that banned detention in our state, all forms, public and private. There is a third form of detention, which is essentially run directly by the federal government. We cannot ban the federal government from enforcing federal laws, so that's not something that we could do, but we banned all public and private contracts. Three out of the four centers closed. Those are the county contracts that we talked about earlier in the Northeast. Last year in February, CoreCivic, which runs the Elizabeth Detention Center, sues the state of New Jersey, saying that the law essentially violates the federal constitution, not the state constitution. I'm not a lawyer, not going to go into it. The judge sided with them in August of 2023. So about 3 or 4 weeks ago, Geo Group, which is the number two largest prison, private prison company in the world, said, we want the same relief that CoreCivic got from the judge. Mind you, that lawsuit is now under appeal. The state of New Jersey has appealed the decision of the judge in the lawsuit that granted CoreCivic the ability to continue operating in the state. So Geo Group says, well, we want to operate in the state too, and actually we have this $100 million contract in Newark to reopen what used to be an immigration detention center called Delaney Hall. Delaney Hall used to be about 450, 500 beds. That's double the capacity of the Elizabeth Detention Center, which means that we'd be doubling our capacity to detain people in the state of New Jersey. It's also right near the airport. So they also have a contract with ICE to be able to deport people out of that airport. So it means that those beds are going to be filled. Also, Delaney Hall technically has the capacity for about three times that number. They have the capacity for almost 1,200 beds. We don't know how big this detention center is going to be. We don't know how quickly they're going to be able to open it, but it's coming. They were granted the same relief as CoreCivic. The state of New Jersey consented to this. A judge has already written up the order. And essentially, Geo Group and CoreCivic, the two largest private prison companies in the world, are now allowed to operate within the state of New Jersey until the CoreCivic lawsuit is resolved. Having spoken to, you know, I'm not a lawyer, but having spoken to several lawyers, we signed on to the amicus brief that the ACLU of New Jersey prepared in this lawsuit. My understanding is that we have a very small chance of having that decision reversed. So what is most likely to happen is that New Jersey will become a state that has only private immigration detention going forward. A little national context, just because I think it's helpful to understand sort of like why everything is such a mess. I have some stats I want to share with you. So there are over 3.5 million cases pending in immigration court across the United States right now. People often talk about, you know, like why does our system not work? Well, we don't have enough judges to handle that, and we don't have enough lawyers. Some states, I just mentioned that you don't have a legal right to representation, and that is true. Some states and some localities, like New Jersey, and New York City, have created publicly funded, so not federally funded, but state or, you know, city-funded programs to give people some kind of access to representation. In New Jersey, we have DDDI, which is like deportation and something defense initiative. I don't remember what it stands for. In New York, you have Knife Up, which I also don't remember what it stands for. But essentially, if you're residents of those places and you're detained or you're in deportation proceedings, you are eligible for legal services. Now, the vast majority of places in the U.S. don't have that. And even still, even with some publicly funded legal services, New Jersey still has the sixth largest caseload in the country, and we're a small state. So that's just sheer numbers. To put into context, New York ranks fourth in the country. But like population-wise, New York City is essentially the same as New Jersey. In a report from January of 2023, it was reported that the average case in immigration court has been pending for over 900 days. Now, that's good, actually. I mean, we have people who have been waiting on their asylum cases for over a decade, you know, who just had it granted. Right now, what's happening is that people who are newly coming in, they're putting people on these, like, fast track, they're calling them rocket dockets, so that they are getting their court dates really, really fast. But if you've been here for a while, you're getting pushed back further and further. And there are so few judges and so many cases going into the immigration court docket that people are getting notices to appear for, like, a decade in the future. So people are coming into this country and just, like, it's pure chaos, essentially, and it's part of it is on purpose. So, as we know, there's lots of things that we can do to support people. And this is a little bit about what we do, and I kind of want to give you a sense of, like, what these services are and what they've meant to people. So we have virtual and in-person visitation. During the pandemic, detention centers expanded their capacity for virtual visitation. It's not great, I have to be honest. The services provided to people in detention are not exactly stellar, but it does allow you to talk to somebody, you know, from anywhere in the world. And the majority of the folks who are actually in our visitation programs are in our virtual programs because the Elizabeth Detention Center has a very short average length of stay, so it's really difficult to actually see somebody while they're there. Often what happens is somebody's detained and sort of held there for a tiny bit and then moved elsewhere, usually to Moshannon, which is in Phillipsburg, Pennsylvania. So we support folks in Buffalo, New York, in Orange County, which is in Goshen, New York, in Moshannon, in Pike County, which is another part of Pennsylvania, and then in the EDC, because that's where people from New Jersey and New York get sent. Those are the main places. But transfers are also used in a retaliatory way. So, you know, we have friends that were transferred all over the East Coast because they dared to speak out about some of the abuse that they were witnessing and experiencing. So virtual visitation is very helpful for when people are not physically located here. We do have a pen pal program as well. Like I mentioned earlier, commissary funding. There has been studies that show that the amount of calories that people are actually fed in detention is literally like not enough for an adult male. So, you know, I literally get letters from friends that are like, thank you for the commissary funding because it's really hard to go to bed on an empty stomach. I mean, it's really sad what we do to people, what our tax dollars fund. We do pay bonds to the extent that we're able to. So this is really just like funds permitting, but it allows people to get out of detention and continue to fight their immigration case from home as opposed to being in a cage. We have volunteers who pick people up as they get out of detention. Actually, that young woman who had been held for 5 years, we had a volunteer who just like picked her up and took her to McDonald's and waited with her for a few hours while a family member drove to come get her from upstate New York. So, you know, our volunteers are really a huge part of what we do. We couldn't, you know, we are a staff of three. We really couldn't do most of what we do without our volunteers. If somebody is being released from a different detention center, sometimes if funds permitting, we'll support with getting them back to New Jersey if that's where they're coming. Sometimes people are going else to, you know, meet a sponsor in a different city, so we'll try and get them a bus ticket, plane ticket, whatever it might be. We do have some volunteers, this is less common now than before, but who will do some short-term hosting. This is particularly important for people who are getting out of detention, who often really don't have many community connections, and interestingly, may not have an ID, and so shelters are not always a place that we can call to house people. So there's only certain shelters that'll work with like undocumented folks who don't have identification or something like that. So we do have some volunteers that'll host folks. We have a hotline. We get a lot of phone calls from just people who are like, I have no idea where to find a food bank. I have no idea where to get like free diapers or whatever it might be. Often it's newly arrived folks. It used to also be a lot of detained, I mean, detained folks do call us on the hotline, but we used to be like a free call and then we got kicked off the free list, you know, the pro bono hotline list. And so it's a little bit more difficult now, but we do a lot of our referrals through our hotline, through people reaching out to us on our WhatsApp. We just, there's all these kinds of ways that folks reach out to us. And it's usually things like, my friend just got detained and I have no idea what to do. Because you don't, right? Like if somebody just gets picked up and you're like, I don't know where they're being taken. I don't know how to call them. I don't know, I mean, there's so many hurdles that you have to jump through. You can't even send a book to somebody in detention unless you do it exactly the right way because it'll be rejected. You know, First Friends used to have a program where we would send people stamps and paper and stationery, and we had to stop doing that because stamps are contraband. So we're not allowed to send people something that will help them basically, you know, continue their immigration case. So yeah, that's a lot. And then accompaniment is actually mostly for non-detained friends. It's a program that we launched last year. So we train our volunteers to basically accompany people to either, most importantly, immigration court hearings, but also ICE check-ins. So for immigration court hearings, typically, I mean, a lot of this is really just about moral support, but it's also about having a second person who is a native English speaker who can hear what the judge is saying, what the DHS attorney is saying, and know, okay, your next court date is on this day, you have to bring X application. It's just kind of a second person taking notes for you. Nope, you know, you're not translating or anything, but you're there for moral support and like a second set of eyes, and frankly, a lot of people have actually told us this about both visitation and accompaniment, that the way that they're treated when they're detained and they have a visitor versus when they don't have a visitor, or the way that they're treated when they walk into a courtroom with community support versus not. You know, I've had judges say to me, wow, all these people are here for this one person, and we're like, yeah, and she's like, okay. That, you know, and they clock it, they notice. So we try to get people, you know, we have an accompaniment coming up where like seven of us are going because it's this person's individual merits hearing for his asylum case. So we try to show up and make sure that we're both watching the court and they kind of know we're watching them, but we're also there to support our friend. And then we do a bunch of advocacy. And a lot of the advocacy work that we do is really tied to that whole trying to disentangle the criminal legal system from the immigration system. And so... No, I'll put that on in a second. There's a couple of bills that we're working on that I would love to just like quickly talk about. One of them that is going to be introduced in New Jersey hopefully soon, hopefully before the end of this month. It was previously called the Values Act. It will be changed to the Immigrant Trust Act. And essentially this would take something that we already have in the state of New Jersey called the Immigrant Trust Directive, which is an attorney general directive, and it would make it law, so it's a lot harder to change, and it would create a super bright line between law enforcement and immigration enforcement. So right now there are a bunch of exceptions that allow police to cooperate with immigration enforcement agents and basically like proactively give them information or hold people for ICE. And this law would not allow for that to happen and would also create a bunch of model privacy policies so that folks never have to share immigration status when interacting with like public agency. And so they don't have to have that fear that if they want to like go get vaccinated, which was a fear during COVID, right? Like going to get vaccinated, going to get a test, all of these things, you know, all our communities are all safer when everybody can avail themselves of community services is what we believe. And so that's sort of the thrust of that bill, and then we're also working on the federal level on a bill called the New Way Forward Act, which seeks to undo a lot of the 1996 laws that we talked about. It will, you know, get rid of mandatory detention. There will be a way for people who have been deported to come back. So there's, you know, there's a lot going on. We also do individual level advocacy. So if you, you know, if we know of somebody who's in detention and they need like community support letters for their bond hearing or whatever it might be, try to rally that, you know, amongst our volunteers and make sure that to the extent possible, anybody who interacts with First Friends feels as though there is a community supporting them. Because immigration, the process of you know, figuring out how to get through or how to apply and get through your court hearings and, you know, going in and out of detention it's incredibly traumatic, yes, but also confusing and bureaucratic. And so we hope that we can provide those supportive services outside of legal services so that people can better navigate that really confusing system. So thank you guys for having me. I hope that you, this is not actually the best way to do this. I should have put up a different thing. But if you do want to hear, learn more about what we do, you can sign up for our newsletter at our website. I would also highly suggest following us on social media because we post a lot. First Friends, so friend with an S, njny.org. And that's our same name on Instagram, First Friends NJNY, without the .org. Yeah. Thank you. Am I supposed to do questions or do you want to? No? I don't know. I'm happy to, but I wasn't sure. I don't want to take up too much time. You tell me. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Excuse me, Katy, if they have questions, they can come up to you after, okay? Thanks.
Thank you very much.
It's not my turn either.
I think we're going to rise in body and spirit for this last, the closing hymn, Comfort Me. We're going to sing Comfort, Sing, and Dance. Now at the same time.
Katy, thank you so much. That was so informative, and it's so disheartening to see how people are still being treated in this day and age. Let's read the words together for extinguishing the chalice. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment.
These we carry in our hearts until we are together again.
When you're down.
We warmly welcome all of you who are visiting us today. Now, let us share a moment of silence reflection to consider today's message and the meaning it has in our lives.